joy of the resurrection for 2.5 hours, and almost all were between the ages of 18 and 30. And no, this wasn't a big and famous university in England, or Rome, or the U.S., or even Toronto. It was right here in Halifax. And here in this chapel, this really wasn't an anomaly, though it is unquestionably a very big worship event for the place. This is a place, a chapel, that serves 2 local universities and is open to all. It is the center of a lot of ongoing activity for a large group of faithful, energetic young adults, the ones you don't often see in churches. Yet each is an individual with her or his very own story. Why is each of them here and not here? How did they get involved in this place? We'll look today at young people embracing a life of faith. And I say embracing such a life to indicate that I'm talking about their choice, their initiative to get up and go to church in the morning, their response to God. Not something dictated by parents, not something uncritically received, but something that becomes essential to their lives. Something that they have taken on as adults, young adults, independently. If we can find such people in our church, that is good news. If they come to faith, and if they persevere beyond the initial stages, then once they're out in the world, finished with school, take on occupations and vocations, they will be in our churches. In the current climate of worry in the church over the small numbers of young adults in the pews, and though I don't have extensive statistics, in the 2001 Canadian census, the Anglican Church had one of the highest median ages of any of the faiths listed. I have seen in this community some good news. With their stories, I wondered, help us to know how they made a decision to be here. The experience of conversion is one of great fascination and interest to me. I was one of those who left the church at an early age, in fact, in university, and stayed away for a very long time. With that change, I was overwhelmed, fascinated, and so very thankful. In addition, I worked for a long time in university among young people. For the last few years, I have worshiped with young people in the chapel community at the university that I spoke of. And I wondered how close their experiences were to mine. I was interested to find out, in a secular university, in the secular world, what brought this to their attention? What made them look away from their busy, exciting, and energetic lives for just a moment to find something that has enriched and deepened those still busy, energetic, exciting lives? In short, I wanted to find out for them what happened. And so the research topic for this study was, how do students at a Canadian university understand and experience coming to Christian faith? The experience being investigated is, of course, commonly called conversion, and this is a good and useful word. For this study, however, it was not assumed that people understand the word conversion in a consistent way, and it was downplayed when speaking with students. To prevent misunderstanding, the word has often been understood as a single, dramatic experience, and this was not necessarily the phenomenon sought here, rather the wider experience of coming to faith, however that happens. Very little research has been published on the faith experiences of university students, still less from Canada, but there has been considerable writing on conversion generally. Pamela Chandler Lee, who has investigated faith experiences of African American women, describes it this way: conversion is an event for some, but for others it has been described as a lifelong complex process, a gradual or religious change, a continual turning, an intellectual or moral shift, or a spiritual journey. William James, a major writer in the field, has said, "To say that one is converted means that religious ideas, previously peripheral, one's consciousness now take a central place, and the religious aims now form the habitual center of one's energy. Christian Smith of the University of Notre Dame begins even farther back with an underlying question. Why has Christianity survived at all? What makes it work for people? And this, for him, can best be examined by delving into the lived experiences of that working. I think that these questions directly relate to the initial experience of coming to faith, because it is the one which can begin a whole lifelong process of living with God as center and focus. And that life is also the life of the church as the body of all the individual faithful. Let's look at what the general student experience is like, the context of their lives. Undergraduate students are apart from their families and home communities. All are in a new academic and social situation, a place of higher expectations, of new and bigger ideas. Their minds are being opened. They are becoming originators of ideas and recipients of knowledge and understanding of centuries. This time can, must, be one of great change. Decisions and patterns of life are being set. In addition to being perhaps undefined in themselves, they are hard for others, including the church, to pigeonhole. Between adolescence and adulthood, they do not always fit into either the youth outreach of the church or the model of young adults who are living independently or are launched. So to themselves, they are in flux, in liminality. To others, they're enigmatic. Outwardly, we may see students who begin to make worship and service a part of their lives, but the inner workings of this process should not be guessed at without attending to individual stories. The goal of this investigation is to understand the student experience as much as possible from the inside, so as to better serve them in ministry. Their coming to faith is, in my opinion, quite worthwhile to investigate. How are we to investigate the experience of others? Qualitative research looks in depth at several experiences to discern common threads, if they exist. As a phenomenological, that is, descriptive study, it asks for and documents the experience of others and seems most appropriate for satisfying my curiosity about what it's like. Interviews of about 45 minutes each were held with five students. These students attend Dalhousie University and the University of King's College, which are associated institutions, and they are known to me through the Anglican worship community in these institutions. They were selected on the basis of their own admission of coming to faith while at university, and on their interest in the question being asked, and their willingness, in fact, eagerness to participate. From the interviews, which themselves are the raw data, themes have been identified. Bias must be avoided in this as in any scientific study. And in asking questions and in analyzing the data, I have consciously tried to filter out my own personal faith and conversion experiences, and as much as possible, the specifics of the place. In a series of eight open-ended, somewhat overlapping questions, students were asked about how their spiritual shift began, the students' experience of significant events and people, and it is their experience of those things we're looking at, how things have changed for them, and at all stages, how it felt. The students themselves, all these are pseudonyms. Maria came from an agnostic, atheist, non-Christian family. Keith was brought up Anglican, but fully to faith before coming to university. Zachary came from a non-religious upbringing. David grew up in another Christian tradition, and like Keith, did not come to faith on his own until at university. And Donna was non-religious, decidedly atheist before attending university. There are many common threads through the students' narratives, and the most frequent ones can be grouped as seen here. Within the community, within self, and the externals, the in response to the very general and overlapping questions asked, the most commonly repeated theme revolved around this sense of community. A community which they described as, in some but not all ways, qualitatively different from the rest of their often active social lives. There is the presence of peer group members, which encourages. There is joyful, rewarding community, and this sometimes also brings challenges. These challenges they see in a new light as compared to their pre-conversion ways. Listen to their words. It is striking that they not only receive what community offers, they give it as well, and this is important to them. Maria expresses belonging and friendship. The community in general is so strong, and sometimes I just can't believe that I'm part of just such an amazing community. I'm a really social person, so I hang out with as many different people as possible. So chapel definitely facilitates. And then we have like an epiphany party happening, and there's all the feast parties, and the after parties for the choir concerts. And it's just like everybody wants to eat and drink together, which is definitely my mandate. Keith speaks of growth and persistence in community. There's always going to be challenges and people in the community that you find it hard to spend time with. Find it hard to work with. There's going to be times when you're frustrated, when you're tired, when you do question your faith, when you do question a lot of things. These are all aspects to it, and you know, in order to grow, in order to be in community, I think there's no question that you have to open yourself up. Zachary describes life-giving interchange. I think a lot of what I've said so far comes down to the community, and being able to be in community, in a knowledgeable community who knows what they're about, what they're doing, and being able to participate and engage with them in a number of different ways. David touches on the surprise and fulfillment of discovering community. What's the phrase I thought recently? Like, adore and endure. Like, sometimes there's people that, well, prior to this I was not forced into any kind of community, or did not have to endure, adore and endure everybody. But once you start to realize that community is so key and important and uplifting, in a way you have to enter into that. Keith also brought up the presence of other students. I have to be careful how I say this, but other churches that you go in, you will seldom see anyone with hair that's not white or gray. And it's young children and people over the age of 50, and there seems to be a huge gap. And the chapel offers a place where you can be around people your own age, people who are older and younger as well, but it's not a divide that is so, I guess, so profound. There were also many comments about inner journeys. It is not surprising that much of it had to do with changing and growing. And with respect to change, I think it is highly significant that for all of these five students, you could sum up the order of things like this. They did not start coming to chapel because they had faith. They came at first for different reasons. Involvement in the choir, invitations by friends, interesting events, intellectual curiosity. Yet after time, having found themselves there, they found faith there. Repeated attendance led or facilitated along various paths to comfort, interest, peace, and a gradual opening to the content of the chapel worship. Hospitality has been seen as the true way of spreading the word, and here perhaps we see examples of that. Let's listen again. Keith. Well, for the very first time I went to King's Chapel, and I should be embarrassed about this, but I'm not, was when I was in foundation year. And a young woman stood up, and this was my very first week at King's, and she stood up and said that there would be Holy Communion on Thursday. And she said that all are welcome to come. There would be a sherry hour afterwards. And I didn't really catch the whole solemn Eucharist part, but that she would be a sherry hour afterwards. And to get to sherry hour, I should go to the chapel. whole life I've grown up atheist. No one in my family was religious at all. And even when I came to Halifax, I was still very firmly atheist. And when I started singing in the chapel choir at King's, I started, at first I was really uncomfortable. But gradually I began to feel more comfortable and comforting walking into the chapel. Like when I came in, I would breathe a sigh of relief and think, okay, I'm home now. So it was such a gradual shift at first, from being atheist to gradually being agnostic, and now changing my beliefs. Maria, I've been singing in a choir since I was really young, so I auditioned for and joined the King's Chapel Choir. I was like, chapel, whatever, okay, like, I've been to church with friends before, you know, and it didn't make me uncomfortable or anything, and I was like, okay, great, whatever. And then I was like, oh God, I'm going to at least two services a week. Okay, I can do it, whatever. And then, so I joined the chapel choir, and that was really powerful. And that's where the shift, like where the really major shift came about. And finally, Zachary. I came to King's College in Halifax for university through participating in Foundation Year Program and in the chapel community, and really gaining more of an understanding and knowledge of what the tradition is and what the history of worship was, and sort of through meditation and lots of reflection, I found that it appealed to me. Another aspect of interior journey which they spoke of was their own change of self-identity after becoming Christian. And this seems to reflect the importance of this shift to them. They also spoke about their independence in making this decision. For example, Maria said, it was crazy, it was like huge, it was so cool that this happened to me at such a conscious time of my life too, which is interesting. In some ways, I'm really happy that I found it myself as an adult. I'm making and made that choice and learned it all now. Because, you know, instead of it being just maybe ingrained from age 5 or something. And all commented on various aspects of their growth in faith after the initial experiences. Their descriptions varied, but the thread of recognizing a new phase and still expanding faith can be seen in this example. David said, when you first start, it's simple. There's only one way, and that's up. And now you're here. And the further you get into actually studying what's going on, studying scripture, the more questions come up. You can put yourself at odds with yourself and what you're reading. And you're just filled with even more questions that are even harder to answer. And you need more of people like the chaplain to come and give you the answer or to ask. It's kind of like, in a way, the heights get higher and the depths get deeper. It's kind of like when you fall, it's farther and harder. And when you go up, it's farther and higher. Maria said, first year was my year of confusion and questioning. And I was like, And doors were opening and I wasn't sure I was going through them. But I was like putting toes through them or whatever. And then second year, it was the year the shift actually happened. And I went through the door. And I was like, whoa, this is happening. I'm like, this year I'm there. I'm no longer like questioning my faith or my religion. I mean, I never really questioned my faith and my religion, but I'm not questioning, I'm just like exploring more. Zachary spoke of perseverance in worship and the change the developing faith has made. You just have to go within you and repeat and make the words your own. Just keep on keeping on. I don't know that there's much more that anybody could do, but at the same time, what more could you want to do? I never expected and never will expect there to be some great revelatory moment when the clouds open and the sky parts and, you know, the angels come down from heaven to touch me on the head. I mean, that would be lovely if it did happen. But for me, participating in faith this way makes me feel more comfortable in my daily life and in my day-to-day routines. I feel much more comfortable speaking to just people in general. Whereas before, the see the point of why I was here, what I was doing, why anybody continued on doing it. Participating in faith in this way just seemed to lend some context, some meaning, and a little bit more texture to the whole, to the experience of life. And in this quote, it was very long and I shortened it considerably, but when he says that he wasn't sure about going on, that was a very deep questioning of going on. It wasn't just going on going to church that he spoke of. This made a really big difference to his particular life. And faith can become central, which is one of those marks of conversion that we heard of earlier. Listen to Keith. I think it's just seeing those of no faith come to faith and seeing those with faith worshiping in the community. I don't think there is a road to Damascus point, but it just, the church became something that doesn't just happen on Sunday. It wasn't just a social event, but this was part of one's life, and as such, as part of your education, as part of everything you do. As well as the sense of community and the students' own tracking of their faith journey, their introspective navigation, a third and very important grouping of themes has to do with what we might call the infrastructure of their experience. There is the worship, which is frequent, rich, very prayerful, and seen as formational, yet without questions or pressure to attend. There are the clergy, the chaplain, and others, who are experienced as surprising, interested, accessible, loving, and integral to the whole experience for the students. And there is the rich and active choice of events, such as social community events, learning opportunities, talks, quiet days, Bible studies, and regular, twice yearly at least, well-attended and ambitious retreats. Many of these activities require a lot of work and responsibility to be shouldered by students as well. So there was plenty of opportunity for involvement. And all of these required great energy on the part of the priest in charge. Yet I do not mean this as a recipe. What I mean is that all of these things were identified by the students themselves as very influential, as having a direct effect on their interior personal conversion and growth in faith. And I think that what they have in common, these aspects, is the attention given to the inner state of these young people. I think we can hear that in these quotes. Oops. Maria said of the retreats, but also about the importance of retreats for talk of God. I love talking to people at retreats, because at retreat, everyone wants to talk about God, which is what I always talk about, like all the time over. While I have these long conversations. And then in real life, people don't have time, or it's not really the field. But at a retreat, it's always the time, and it's always the field, so I like talking to people. Keith said of worship at the daily offices, you know, 8 o'clock in the morning on a cold February, someone standing alone in a cassock and singing the daily office, and walking in and seeing no one else there, that this one person is singing the daily office, and then they're on their knees, just the beauty of that. And seeing that is worshiping God for his glory and nothing else than his glory, and that, I think there are moments like that that are so profound that whether or not I realized it at the time, that definitely shaped my faith. And Keith also spoke of opportunities for service with the chapel's activities. And those around me, there's no question that Christ is in all of us through friendships, through introductions, through guest preachers, through doing outreach projects in the community, through getting to know people who have absolutely nothing physically, sometimes not even the use of their own body, but being invited to have eyes and see those things, to have ears and hear those things. That strength comes through what this community is and what this community provides. And all spoke of the role of the spiritual leader, the chaplain. I've heard, in their words, comments on welcoming, on interest, on comfort, and on prayer. Here's a comment by David. went in, and here he has him aside. The other thing about the church I was raised in, anyway, is that it's so big that you could never, it's really hard to garner a personal relationship with the priest. Because he's so, he'll talk to you on the way out, but there's no way he knows names except for the very few key people in the parish. And when I first came in here, in the chapel, there was a chaplain in his clericals cleaning up the chapel, and he came and shook all of our hands, and I thought, oh, that's nice. But I mean, we're only supposed to be there for 5 minutes. We were there for about 15 or 20. And he's talking about the, you know, tradition within it. Why it's this and why it's that. And I was completely lost, but also sort of completely entranced. Because I was like, wow, here's someone who not only is kind of like really passionate about meeting me and interested in who I am and wants to know my name, but here's someone who's passionate about what it all really means. Maria describes interactions which make her and other students feel welcome. I always see first years coming to chapel and they're like coming for the first time and they're just like, oh, okay, this is all right, I guess. And they're like, church, you know, I guess I should be on my best behavior. And then they're leaving and Father Thorne's like, ah, ha, ha, and clapping them on the back. And they're always like looking a bit surprised, right, but happy about it. And they're like, oh, I guess it's okay to be laughing really loudly and hugging each other after church or whatever. And obviously he's really welcoming with a blessing. I always feel that he's like so glad that he's able to bless me or that I have to do. A comment by Keith. But I think there is no question there are important individuals, and without naming those individuals for the most part, there's no question that the priest that we have now has been influential for so many, bringing people to the chapel. But it's not just bringing people to the chapel. It's not a question of numbers in the pews. But it's a question of having a chaplain, having a spiritual leader who is able to preach, who is able to draw the best out of this community as possible, and to inspire and challenge us. And I think that direction is key. Donna said, the chaplain has been amazing. I guess society has certain beliefs about what ministers and priests are supposed to be like, and he just doesn't kind of fit into any of that. I never really had encountered any kind of priest before, and I met him. He's like this guy, he's like my dad, kind of. He'll ask how your day was. But he's also a very important spiritual leader as well. He's definitely been very important in that journey. I think what I'd like, one thing I'd like to emphasize again, if I didn't mention it earlier, is the sense of surprise that the students have had at being noticed, remembered, approached, appreciate. I think that this is an important theme in their personal relationship with their faith now. So, to sum up, I've described three main categories of strong and highly interrelated themes of personal experience, which emerged in speaking with the students. The first, community. A welcoming, strong, fun, engaging group which lives on Christian faith and hospitality. Second, the interior journey, being grasped by a new faith in this place, through the first stirrings of faith, then through growth and perseverance in God's love. And thirdly, the effect of the infrastructure of the community and the worship experience as it relates to individual needs and development and fosters growth in faith, understanding, and love. In their personal stories, we have heard of experiences which surprised, which broke down common notions, which sparked inner journeys, helped them to navigate, helped them even to know that there is something to navigate towards. I think that we can see these things as roles played. Worship, people, including friends, clergy, models and mentors, ideas of meaning, and community and its values have all been integral to the unfolding of their stories. Louis Rambo, an important investigator and scholar of conversion, has identified stages of conversion. I can tell you them after, but I'm going to make it brief. Previous to encounter with the faith tradition, this is the fourth stage. He describes stages of crisis and quest. In this study, these stages do not really appear. The student's presence in the place preceded the beginning of their journey. Perhaps openness was in them, but quests for faith were not a strong common theme. Instead, they found themselves in a place, at a university, where being there was somewhat normal. And once there, they made great discoveries, and their lives were altered. Perhaps, I hope, their experiences can be useful to others in the church. Comfort, interest, and fellowship bring people in. Opportunities catch imaginations and deepen the ties. Prayer, faith, and growth follow. Time has not permitted today a full recounting of the richness of the interviews which the students graciously gave, but I hope that a flavor of their experiences has been revealed. I thank them for their faithfulness and their generosity.
Okay, these guys are doing something that the rest of us aren't. Yep. The hook there in the foundation year program where a pretty girl gets up and talks about a sherry hour works great in a university congregation. My question is, what about outside of that? How do we hook the people in? How do we get them through the door in the first place so that we can start engaging them, start involving them and working with the best?
And really, in the study that I've done here, which is a limited one that is documenting these experiences and looking at the themes of what made a difference to these people, I haven't gone into that question, but it's been a big question in my mind, too. I think a significant thing that I found is, which I already knew, but it certainly came out also from students, said the incredible amount of energy and work that it takes to mount the scale of things that are done there to interest the students. Now, you know, maybe in a parish, you couldn't do anywhere near that much, but maybe you could do some of it. You know, I mean, that could just be my guess. If I were in a parish that was, you know, wasn't drawing young people very much, that's what I'd want to try, to do things like that, to get them in. And, you know, all these aspects of interest in the person and making them have their peers there and having things to do with it, make it worth their while to get out of bed and come. I think that has a big effect on their ultimate path.
Let's say Ricky and Nicole. Ricky.
Kind of feeding off of what Shirley said and in small conversations here, did the question come up about whether these university conversions, you said they take part in chapel on campus, but I was wondering about being a part of a congregational parish beyond that. Do you know what I mean?
Yeah. Some of the students actually are parts of parishes beyond that. Ones are on the peninsula, basically. Like St. Paul's and St. George's specifically, and I know that there's one, I can't quite remember which one. So yes, they do get out there and do other things. The main worship in the chapel is on a Thursday. There is worship on Sunday morning, but a lot of the students don't go there on Sunday morning, they go somewhere else. To me, like, an interesting outgrowth of your question is, you know, I would love to talk to these people 5, 10 years from now. I would love to be able to do that because I think that would be extremely valuable information. Or, you know, just even if you could find a group of people that had been through that, you know, say 5 individuals and find out how it played out for them, because that's a huge outcome.
Thanks very much for your presentation. It reminded me in a number of ways of my own undergrad experience of being part of a cadre of young people within a parish context. And it's tempting with your presentation to think beyond it, to how do these ideas cross or not cross over into the rest of church land. And one of the things I wonder if you could comment on is the utter transience of that time of life. Because unlike a parish model, where the parish needs to change because the congregation is stable, it's sort of the opposite in a university setting where the community is constantly changing.
Yes.
So there can be, paradoxically, a real stability to what happens there.
Yeah.
Knowing that the movement of faith takes individuals away from that place rather than necessarily revolving the community.
Yeah. Yeah, it is a very different thing. It's like, you know, in a family, a child grows up and is with the family through all the stages, and a teacher can be very, very expert in teaching, you know, grade 6. So it's a different setting for that child in one of those places. Again, I would love to see some follow-up on this in a few years' time. I think that does this study. It's interesting, I'm standing here trying to remember the name of the person. But there was somebody who, way back in the 1930s, somewhere in the US, was writing about university students and faith. And what he wrote sounds like it could be said exactly today. And what he was really commenting on was the sort of state of flux and change that we're in. He said the one thing that's different about students at a university, as opposed to the same people who are outside working in jobs or something like that, is that these people have the room socially in every other way to sort of spread out, try new things, be themselves, be different. You know, in his setting, it was like they were being brave enough to sort of turn away from faith to some other faith. In our setting, it's they're being brave enough to even think, you know, I could say to somebody, I'm a Christian. Because in today's world, that's a very big thing. But, you know, there's at least one of the quotes today that would sort of tie into something he said. And he said the two absolute top things that are spoken about in students and dorms are sex and God. Now, that sounded a bit like, no, it's not what we heard today, but, you know, it's the same things. They're young people. And this is, you know, these are both very big things. They both involve expansions in your life, new life as an adult. Thinking about God for yourself is a very big part of that. I mean, obviously, I hope that these students continue that in their further lives. I would dearly want to know what they do.
Maybe just trying to put together your piece and Karen's work as well. Am I correct in hearing that the students found it relatively easy to talk, God talk with you? They could talk about faith, belief, God, Christ?
Yes, absolutely.
They had language, they knew how to use it, they weren't self-conscious.
Yeah. None of these were first-year students.
You mentioned the eagerness even to talk to you.
They were eager. There was one student who, when she finished, you know, she talked for ages and ages, talked fast, lots of words came in. And you know, when she finished, and I said, well, anything else you want to say? Because I'd asked that a couple times, got long answers. She just went, oh, no, I think I got it all out.
Any sense as to, because you know, one of the problems that we have is we, to my mind, collectively, we are not very good at talking about why it's so wonderful to have a faith in Jesus Christ. Mm-hmm. And these people seem to be able to do that unselfconsciously.
Yeah.
Did you get any sense, is that because they're in university, because they're talking all the time about everything, about sex of God in the dorm, you know? Is there anything that we could learn from their, just that they have language and that they're willing to use it, that might spill over? Like I would wonder what would happen if five of them went to, you know, anybody's charge or parish church.
Yeah.
Would the older people just go, ah, I can't do this, or would they? You know, do you have anything to throw into that mix?
Well, probably. You know, they're young, and so they're willing to sort of get out there and take chances and stuff, and they're having fun, they're being themselves. But like, one of the people spoke of, she lives in a house with a bunch of guys and another girl or something like that. None of them had anything to do with the church at all. But they're really supportive of her, and she said that, you know, at first, she hadn't been talking about it much, but then she sort of started talking about it, and they were like, oh yeah, that's fine, you know. And they were surprised at first, a little taken back, but you know, they just came to think, oh, well, that's just what she does, you know, and that's great. And she said, oh, so I talk about to them a lot because when I'm trying to think of things through them, you know. So I got the sense, I can't remember the words, but I got the sense that probably the first time she brought this up, she was sort of crossing the line that she hadn't crossed before. She was quite willing to cross it, but she knew that there was a line. And then once she crossed it, well, it wasn't so bad. So she made that discovery for herself. I think as, you know, adults and some of us who are just newly retired, you know, at these stages of our lives, you know, probably anybody who's shy about talking to this, anybody in our own sort of cohort, and they just always supposed to be researchers and finding out new things. I would love to follow up on this. So I hope I can figure out.
Okay.
What a rich time we've had already today. First evangelism's dirty words that need to be reclaimed, and then we move into the life experience and orbit of university students. As they, in many cases, you saw, I love the profile at the very outset of the students and their journeys. So they, in two cases, at least came from an agnostic or atheistic background to discovering a faith that's obviously made a huge difference in their lives and begs for a longitudinal study of the kind of ramifications of this experience has had over time. So far we've moved deeply into patterns of belief and concerns that are critical to our students and our researchers. And Vivian has taken us on a lovely exploration this afternoon, I think, of university experiences and their conversion. Vivian, thank you so much.